A very good evening to everyone, and a very warm welcome once again to the ISA online PG class. This is
Shant. Good evening.
Oh, good evening, sir. Good evening.
Good evening. Sorry for this technical thing, and welcome to ISA online PG class, 27 December 2022 on hydrocephalus and meningobilocel by Bakangis Karnik, professor of anesthesiology at Medical College. Visiting professor at Stanford University Hospital, fellow Alto US in 2000, more than 40 publications in national and international journals, numerous book chapters, and she is editor of A Practical Approach to Anesthesia for Emergency Surgery, 2011, and reviewer for 5 journals and editorial committee members. Welcome, madam, and thank you for sparing your valuable time on speaking on hydrocephalus and meningomyelocele. Over to Nishant for further proceedings, please.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Over to you, Nishant.
Right, sir. A very warm welcome, ma'am. And you may please share your slides, ma'am.
Yeah, sure. I will be starting.
So the plan for the day, ma'am, is that we'll be keeping all the participants muted till the time your presentation is going on.
Okay.
Just in case there are any queries or questions that the listeners might have, they will type in the chat box. And if there are any questions or queries that you might have from the participants, then they can also answer in the chat box.
Right. Okay, can I start?
Yes. Yes, ma'am. In the slide share mode, please.
I believe my slides are visible now and I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am. You are visible. Your slides are, you are audible also.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank ISA and its office bearers, especially the governing council, especially Dr. Naveen Malhotra, honorary secretary, for giving me this opportunity. Today we have two topics to discuss, hydrocephalus and meningomyelocele. I'll be starting with the first topic, that is hydrocephalus. Let me first create the scenario for us so that we can understand better. Our first case is a 3.5 years old male child weighing 12 kg. His parents has brought him to the hospital with the complaints of frequent crying since 1 week, lethargy with vomiting for 2 days, excessive drowsiness for 1 day. Since birth, he had large head and there were no history of convulsions. But the parents also gave history of ventriculoperitoneal shunt done for this child at the age of 4 months of age, for congenital hydrocephalus under general anesthesia, and there were no perioperative complications. He was delivered by the full-term cesarean delivery and there was no history of NICU admission. He achieved the milestones little later, sitting without support at 12 months of age and standing without support 15 months of age. Until now, he requires some support for walking. In the maternal history, there is nothing much known. Mother gives history of fever of unknown origin during the pregnancy, but no details are known. On examination, the patient was drowsy, responding to painful stimulus. Vital parameters were stable. Head circumference was 57 centimeters. Respiratory system revealed occasional bilateral crepes. CVS system had no murmurs. Consciousness-wise, he was not opening his eyes and just responding verbally by grunting sound. So even M5, V2 he was. Abdomen was mildly distended, but not tense. Investigations were practically all normal, except the fundus showed papilledema grade 2. His CT brain showed dilated ventricles with VP shunt in C2. So the neurosurgeons had decided to do urgent revision VP shunt for this child. Before we start anesthetizing this patient, let us recapitulate our basics. As we all know, cerebrospinal fluid is formed in the lateral ventricles by the choroid plexus. From there, through foramen of Monroe, it goes into the third ventricle. Then through the aqueduct of Sylvius, it goes into the fourth ventricle. And from that, through the foramina of Lushka and Magendie, it goes into the subarachnoid space, spinal as well as the cranial subarachnoid space, and where it is absorbed by, through the arachnoid villi into the superior sagittal sinus. The rate of formation is about 0.5 ml per minute. So roughly in a day, the whole CSF volume gets replaced 4 times in a day. Most of the CSF volume remains in the spinal subarachnoid space, and with only little 25 ml to 30 ml remaining in the intracranial compartment. It plays an essential role of homeostasis of the brain's ECF and maintains a normal neuronal function by providing some micronutrients to the cerebral tissue, clearing waste products for of nerve metabolism and maintenance of ionic homeostasis. It acts as a mediator of intracranial compliance because of its free flow between the cranial and spinal compartments. Coming to hydrocephalus, the word hydrocephalus is derived from Greek words hydro meaning water and kephalos meaning head. And one definition suggested for this is an active distension of ventricular system of the brain related to inadequate passage of CSF from its point of production to its point of absorption into the systemic circulation. There are different ways the hydrocephalus can be classified, but the commonest one classification is non-communicating hydrocephalus, which becomes which occurs because of the obstruction to CSF flow during any of its passages, and communicating hydrocephalus, which is usually occurring because of the excessive secretion or inadequate absorption of CSF. There are multiple causes for hydrocephalus. The communicating one is caused by achondroplasia, several craniofacial syndromes, skull-based deformities, subarachnoid or intraventricular hemorrhage, choroid plexus papilloma, and post-infectious. Amongst that, in our country, commonest is tuberculous meningitis. Non-communicating one, the commonest is aqueductal stenosis. It can also occur secondary to Chiari malformations, Dandy Walker malformations, tumors, especially in the posterior fossa, and there it can also happen secondary to hematomas, infarcts, and the tuberculous meningitis also may lead to non-communicating hydrocephalus. The presentation of these patients will depend upon the basic pathology because of which the hydrocephalus has occurred, its site of obstruction, speed of onset, age of the patient. If the hydrocephalus occurs very very slowly, chronic onset, and if the child is infant, then there is a possibility that there will be large head, sunset eyes, as you can see in the picture, irritability, headaches, poor feeding, delayed milestones, confusion, lethargy, weakness, unsteady gait, seizures. Such non-specific signs are likely to be, symptoms are likely to be there. If it is acute onset, then the presentation may be a little severe. There can be severe headache, vomiting, dehydration, unconsciousness. It may lead to neurogenic pulmonary edema, brainstem herniation, and even cardiorespiratory arrests have been reported. In addition, there can be signs like widening of the sutures, enlargement of the head circumference, crackpot sign, papilledema, as shown in the picture, which may revert back to the normal after the ICP is corrected. Evidence of increased ICP like frontal bossing, dilated scalp veins, cranial nerve pulses, bradycardia, hypertension, depressed consciousness, evidence of pulmonary aspiration may also be there. There can be associated syndromic features and signs related with the basic pathology like tuberculous meningitis signs. Then evidence of tumor, hemorrhage might also be there. The typically hydrocephalus is diagnosed by CT or MRI. As far as the CT criteria, there will be CT MRI criteria, there can be loss of sulci or gyri. Then dilated ventricles, the visibility of the temporal horn of the lateral ventricles can also suggest hydrocephalus. Then, typically, to identify, Evans ratio is measured. That is the ratio of largest width of the frontal horn to maximum parietal diameter. If it is more than 30%, that it is diagnostic of hydrocephalus. This dilatation of the frontal horns also lead to a typical appearance, Mickey Mouse appearance, because of the ballooning of the frontal horns, and that also may be diagnostic. Similarly, on sagittal MRI, there can be upward bowing of the corpus callosum, that is also indicative of hydrocephalus. If it is obstructive hydrocephalus, if it is communicating hydrocephalus, then you will be able to see all four ventricles dilated, including the fourth ventricle. One can also note the periventricular edema as shown over here. Such a large amount of edema not only suggests that there was hydrocephalus, but also that ICP was very significantly high and it needs immediate management. Similarly, on the CT pictures, one can also notice the cortical thickness. It gives us an idea about the prognosis as well. Like if the cortical matter is less than 1 centimeter thick, then probably the patient may not regain, may not have the normal brain function later on also, even after the hydrocephalus has been treated. It can also be diagnosed in utero by during the fetal USG, and ventriculomegaly more than 10 millimeter is diagnostic. In that case, once we suspect that, ultra-fast fetal MRI may be done to identify the condition. After birth, large head is one suspicious sign, and otherwise then in neonate and infants, USG skull will be useful. Dilated ventricles can also be seen using the USG. Transcranial Doppler is rarely used for diagnosis of the hydrocephalus. However, it can be used for identifying the severity of the hydrocephalus by using the several indices and so on. Just to give one example, this is one patient where compression on the anterior frontanally has caused reversal of the flow in the anterior cerebral artery. And this suggests that the ICP is very high and it requires immediate decompression. So for such things, transcranial Doppler may be used. If not treated, it can have worse sequelae. There can be irreversible cellular damage due to gliosis, neuroinflammation, demyelination, axonal degeneration, metabolic impairment, altered neuronal connectivity, and even cell death. So it should be treated at the earliest. Initially, to some extent, diuretics and acetazolamide may be useful. However, the surgical drainage of the CSF would be required for the management. As a temporizing measure, one can use the intermittent ventricular tapping or external ventricular drainage. But for permanent measures, CSF diversion procedures, most commonly ventriculoperitoneal shunt, and less commonly ventriculopleural or ventriculoatrial shunt or thecoperitoneal shunt may be used. Alternatively, endoscopic third ventriculostomy also can be done. Coming to the most common condition, surgery, ventriculoperitoneal shunt, how it is done, as we all know, through the right parietal burr hole, a ventricular catheter is inserted into the lateral ventricle. Then it is connected behind the ear with a valve, and a long extra tubing has been placed through the subcutaneous tunneling into the peritoneal cavity. In India, the commonest shunt that is being used is the Chhabra shunt. It is a spring-loaded shunt having the fixed pressure. There are three types are available: low pressure, medium pressure, and high pressure shunt. And medium pressure is the most commonly being used for most of the VP shunt cases. in rare cases, when the repeated adjustments of the pressures are needed, then adjustable or programmable valves can also be used. When these patients come for the surgery, there are multiple perioperative challenges. These patients may have undiagnosed genetic abnormalities. If the patient is very small, there can be prematurity-associated comorbidities. In neonate and pediatric populations, we'll have their own neurophysiological differences as compared to the older ones. There can be distortion of normal and airway anatomy because of the sheer size of the large head. And in additional problems can occur because of the increased ICP, aspiration, and so on. So during the preoperative assessment, one has to check the history, especially the onset and chronicity of the symptoms, consciousness, vomiting, increased seizure activity. If the patient has undergone previous surgeries, that needs to be asked. Birth and immunization history should be asked. On examination, look for the size of the head, whether bulging fontanelli suggesting raised ICP is present or no. Quite often these patients have deficient nutrition and there can be dehydration. Respiratory system may show the apneic episodes, irregular respiration, pulmonary aspiration, and associated pulmonary tuberculosis or other concurrent infections. There can be bradycardia, tachycardia, or hypotension, and check the CNS thoroughly, Glasgow Coma Scale, consciousness, cranial nerve functioning, motor system, everything should be assessed and documented. Per abdomen also, we should rule out any abdominal pathology, especially tuberculosis and things like that. Associated anomalies are also very frequent in these patients. So one should try and identify. Of the severe most associated anomalies are the vectoral H, that is the vertebral anomalies, anal atresia, cardiac defects, tracheoesophageal fistula, renal and radial abnormalities, limb abnormalities, along with hydrocephalus. So this is considered the worst problem. Apart from that also, there are several cardiac anomalies reported. AST, VST, PDA, cardiomyopathy have been reported. There can be associated craniofacial anomalies, especially Crouzon syndrome and Apert syndrome. This can be associated with the midface hypoplasia. So this can lead to difficult airway, difficult mask ventilation, intubation, as well as post-extubation. Even with the Apert syndrome, IV access would be really tough. The other neurosurgical anomalies associated would be spina bifida and meningomyelocele, which is the most common. Chiari malformation is another dreaded complication. I will come to that a little later. There can be Dandy-Walker malformation leading to high pressure in the posterior fossa. Corpus callosum agenesis can cause delayed recovery. Klippel-Feil syndrome may lead to difficulty in neck movements, making the airway difficult again. So one has to identify all these things. A few words about the Chiari malformation. Arnold Chiari malformation 2 is due to caudal displacement of the cerebellar vermis. Fourth ventricle and lower brainstem goes below the foramen magnum, leading to medullary cord compression. This may lead to several lower cranial nerve pulses. There can be vocal cord paralysis, respiratory distress, abnormal swallowing, leading to pulmonary aspiration and all. And if there is any head flexion, that may aggravate the brainstem compression. So one has to be extremely careful and avoid neck flexion. And for all positioning, it has to be, we have to be really careful. Preoperative investigations would be our standard CBC, ESR, urine routine microscopic. We patient usually does not require much blood loss. So grouping should be done, but cross-matching is not really required in these cases. However, fundoscopy would be required to note the presence of raised ICP. RFT, serum electrolyte, is also needed because of the associated abnormalities in the sodium balance, especially. CSF studies will be required because infected CSF you would not like to put into another body cavity. The diagnostic investigations like CT or MRI brain would be useful. Transcranial Doppler may be useful for the infants and children. An additional test, especially the ECG 2D echo, may be appropriate for syndromic babies and so on. X-ray chest would be required for tuberculosis meningitis patients. There are additional issues. What do you consider this patient's weight? Do you consider the actual weight for blood volume calculations, drug doses calculations? Let me know your opinion in the chat box. Coming to the preoperative management, avoid dehydration, avoid overstarvation. 2 hours of clear liquids starvation is quite sufficient. Optimize the volume and electrolyte status as far as possible before the surgery. Antibiotic prophylaxis must be given. Always be ready for difficult airway, especially with the large head. And check postoperative availability of ventilator if glaucoma scale is 9 or less. This large head also poses problems in the positioning. Even in the while lying supine, the neck will be in the flexed position, and that itself can cause airway obstruction. So a specific position needs to be given for routine positioning as induction as well as intubation. And these patients often require use of multiple pillows or folded bed sheets or towels to raise the torso up, and the head can be supported on a head ring so that the head can be aligned without flexion. Even the IV lines may be significantly difficult in some of these patients, especially those who are coming for repeated surgeries. On the other hand, in a patient with large head and raised ICP, there can be dilated scalp veins, which can be easy to take and which can be used temporarily before you can obtain the regular IV access in the other limbs. So this can be used favorably. Intraoperative monitoring would include the standard monitoring, non-invasive monitoring, ECG, SpO2, NIBP, ETCO2, temperature, urine output, and blood glucose monitoring. Always ensure that antibiotics and anticonvulsants, if appropriate, are given before the induction. Avoid sedative premedications in unsupervised area. Glycopyrrolate and atropine, nowadays the its role is decreasing. More and more number of anesthetists are not using it unless the patient shows bradycardia, raised ICP. In those cases, probably still it has a role. Induction, usually with raised ICP patients, IV induction is preferred using either thiopentone or propofol. However, sevoflurane in incremental doses may be used in very small infants, patients with difficult airway, or when there is no IV access. But mind well, as soon as the patient is immobilized, immediately the IV must be secured. Succinylcholine may be used in this patient, but nowadays we do not prefer succinylcholine unless and until it is absolutely mandatory for some reason. Fast intubation may be achieved using rocuronium or atracurium. Some patients will require rapid sequence intubation, but not all. If adequate starvation is there, if the stomach is emptied, then the regular intubation may be done. Direct laryngoscopic is the most common way of doing it. Maintenance can be either inhalational or propofol infusion with or without nitrous oxide. It depends upon the age and the condition of the patient. And analgesia will be again combination of the opioids and non-opioids. The management principles, we have to ensure that adequate cerebral perfusion is reaching the patient. Mind well that in infants, cerebral perfusion pressure is much lower as compared to adult. And cerebral blood flow also in infant is much lower. However, it is higher for children. So always treat the hypotension promptly with the preferably balanced salt solution. Avoid hypercarbia and hypoxia because it will cause the further increase in the ICP. Excuse me. Routinely, we use hyperventilation to reduce the ICP for raised ICP cases. But in hydrocephalus patient, look at the brain tissue. If it is such a large dilated ventricles, the hyperventilation is not going to be helpful in reducing the ICP. On the contrary, it may reduce the blood flow to the brain and may pose the risk of ischemia. So it should be avoided. Maintain normocarbia. Reduce the head rotation and avoid PEEP so that the venous drainage is not affected. Often mannitol or hypertonic saline may be needed before surgery to reduce the ICP, and avoid hypo and hyperglycemia and do the glucose monitoring, especially in infants. These patients are also prone to hypothermia. Even if the surgery does not last for very long duration, there is extensive surgical area. The large head, neck, chest, and abdomen, everything is being scrubbed. So one has to use the warm scrubbing solutions, warm IV fluids, warming mattresses underneath the patient should be useful, because over the patient, there is hardly any space to put the blankets. Covering the extremities with the cotton blankets would be appropriate, and closed circuit with low flows will be helpful. In addition, when the surgeon is doing the ventricular puncture, the sudden release of the ventricular pressure or release of ICP can lead to bradycardia and hypotension. So one has to be alert for this. Similarly, while tunneling the catheter, it is a highly painful procedure, subcutaneous tunneling. So before that, one should ensure the adequate analgesia. Usually an additional dose of bolus dose of fentanyl would be appropriate. Antiemetics can be given before the end of the surgery because there is high chance of vomiting. They can be reversed and extubated if they are conscious preoperatively. However, if the patient is preoperatively unconscious, have apneic spells and comorbidities, probably ventilatory support may be considered. There are multiple complications that can occur, especially the high failure rate of CSF shunts are there because of the valve malfunction, disconnection, over drainage can also occur because of either the drainage at the time of ventricular catheter insertion or because of the multiple pumping of the valve. As shown over here, there is a sunken can lead to reverse coning of the patient. There can be infection, obstruction, failure of absorption from the peritoneum can lead to large amount of abdominal distension. This can cause abdominal splinting of the diaphragm and respiratory distress. So that needs to be watched for and treated at the earliest. If the patient happens to be neonate, then there are additional issues. Like all the bones are floating, so the positional issues are significant. We have to be extremely careful while handling the head and placing it on a soft gel pads or a ring would be appropriate. There can be additional problems related with the prematurity, like anemia, coagulopathy, jaundice, or underdeveloped lungs. Airway problems, we know that neonates will have multiple. Those things need to be taken care about. If the patient happens to be tuberculous meningitis patient and coming for with hydrocephalus, then TBM is the most devastating form of tuberculosis. Usually it is not the primary, so there is almost always associated pulmonary tuberculosis, which might be active. There can be miliary tuberculosis. Intracranial tuberculomas are also present, which will lead to raised ICP. Quite often these patients would be on AKT and anticonvulsants, which itself will cause enzyme induction, which can affect the metabolism of anesthesia-related drug-resistant, multi-drug-resistant tuberculosis, or HIV co-infection is also possible. So in those situations, there will be risk of transmission of disease to the coexisting to the people who are working in the theaters. There can be malnourished. We had done the study and we had found that with tuberculous meningitis, the malnourishment is the most common factor. There can be low serum albumin, hyponatremia, decreased consciousness, and ventilatory support is also very high in these patients. Hemodynamic instability, need for vasoactive drugs is also common in these patients. If the ventriculoperitoneal shunt fails, the surgeon may often do ventriculoatrial shunt. especially in case of the abdominal pseudocyst or when the absorption is not appropriate from the abdomen. For ventricular atrial shunt, preoperatively 2D echo is must to identify or rule out the intracardiac problems or defects. USG neck vessels is also essential to ensure that there is no blockage or thrombosis of the neck vessels. Antibiotic prophylaxis is must for ensuring protection against the bacterial endocarditis. Our anesthesia protocol is almost same as the ventriculoperitoneal shunt, but avoid the instrumentation. There can be some air bubble going into the heart and therefore monitor for air embolism. When the surgeon is handling or inserting the catheter, there can be intraoperative arrhythmias. Fluoroscopic guidance may be needed, so additional radiation hazards are also to be considered. Postoperatively, CT scan may be needed to confirm the placement. Too much of volume suddenly going into the heart can also lead to congestive heart failure, so one should be actively watching out for this, especially on the day one. Later on, there can be jugular venous thrombosis. Coming to another temporizing measure is external ventricular drainage. The common indications for this is acute or new onset hydrocephalus, intraventricular hemorrhage. In case of posterior fossa tumor, still the surgeon can remove the tumor. Definitive surgery can be done, probably EVD may be helpful, but important indication is infected CSF. The infected CSF cannot be diverted into another body cavity. It has to come out while the surgeon is treating the patient with the antibiotics and so on. So EVD would be inserted, and the problem itself is it can be a source of infection. So within few days, after the CSF is cleared, be patient. So when the EVD is in situ, one has to take due care of it. Handling should always precautions. Because it is a valveless system, there can be excessive drainage possible, especially if the tubing is kept lower. So height of the column must be carefully adjusted and monitored. Measured quantity can be removed so that sudden decompression can be prevented. If it is closed during the transport, when the patient comes back to the table or his bed, ensure that it is opened and it is functioning. Now, quite often, V patient is done after the EVD is inserted. In this case, is EVD is blocked on the previous night so that the ventricles will dilate, and during the VP shunting, the ventricular puncture can be taken easily. So intentionally ventricles are dilated, so ICP is intentionally increased. So such patients can come in deteriorated condition on table. So one has to be very, most always ICP is raised and due precautions need to be taken. Sometimes even we may have to resuscitate these patients preoperatively by immediately opening up the EVD and resuscitating if the patient shows arrhythmias or respiratory arrest. So in such patient, the V patient can be done few hours later after the patient stabilizes and so on. So one has to be extremely careful with the blocked EVD especially. In this era of minimally invasive is also not far behind. With the possibility of the clear structures visible, full ventricular system can be seen. Third ventriculostomy can be done for the hydrocephalus patients. How it is done? The rationale for it is because the CSF is produced in the lateral ventricle, battery of the multiple ventricles, and then into the subarachnoid space. But if you can connect the third ventricle directly into the subarachnoid space, then you are bypassing the aqueduct of Sylvius. So this way, directly the pathology is alleviated and the patient gets treated without diverting the CSF anywhere outside. So how it is done? Non-communicating hydrocephalus, and for patients having age more than 6 months, this can be done. The surgeon will do the right frontal burr hole. Through that, the endoscope is inserted into the lateral ventricle. With the continuous fluid irrigation, it is advanced into the third ventricle. Usually the foramen of Monroe in hydrocephalus is very enlarged, so it can easily go through that. Then the floor of the third, it's the thinnest part of the brain, which can be punctured, dilated with removed, and the skin and subcutaneous tissue is closed. I would like to ask the audience why it is not done, usually not advocated below the 6 months of age. Again, in the chat box. If you see the picture inside the scope, this is the lateral ventricles. We can see the dilated foramen of Monroe, and then in the third ventricle, this is the floor of the third ventricle. Mammillary bodies are visible. Infundibular recess is visible. And then just behind the infundibular recess, there is a small area which is punctured and the ventriculostomy is performed. But this area happens to be bang in the center of circle of Willis. And note the proximity with the basilar artery and other vessels. So one has to be extremely careful. Perfect, and the patient should be completely immobilized. If any of the vessel is punctured or damaged, there can be significant risk of bleeding. And once the risk occurs, the patient surgeon loses the view, and nothing else can be done further till the view clears, CSF clears. So anesthesia for this neuroendoscopy will involve standard non-invasive monitoring, but the blood to be done, and it should be readily available. The principles of anesthesia of the patient: cardiovascular stability, ICP control, preservation of cerebral blood flow, and rapid emergence to assess the neurological status. Most of the drugs remain same as the V-patient, but here again we would like to avoid the nitrous oxide. Since the continuous irrigation fluid is used, there is a risk of aseptic meningitis, which can cause fever. If normal saline is used for irrigation, then it can cause CSF acidosis, and Ringer lactate is associated with the hyperkalemia. But one of the dreaded problems is the acute rise in ICP. If this irrigation goes into the patient and outlet of the scope is blocked. So constant watch of the inlet as well as outlet must be kept. The intraoperative problems can be sudden bradycardia at the time of ventriculostomy, hypotension and hypertension, both are possible. Even cardiac arrest have been reported. There can be neurogenic pulmonary edema associated with the increased ICP. And if intraoperative bleeding occurs, there is nothing much can be done apart from frequent irrigation of the CSF. If water column tamponade is used to prevent the bleeding, there can be severely increasing ICP. So that should be discouraged or not done. Very large amount of bleeding may warrant emergent craniotomy. There can be hyper or hypokalemia postoperatively. There can be hematoma. Because the dura is not really closed postoperatively, there can be CSF leak. Pneumoventricle is a very common finding after the neuroendoscopy. Again, hydrocephalus does not occur only in babies or because of the congenital hydrocephalus. There are multiple causes. And one such condition is occurring in the elderly patients, normal pressure hydrocephalus. It's a hydrocephalus occurs because the absorption becomes poor and poor slowly over the years. Typically, they present with the gait disturbances, urinary incontinence, and cognitive decline. And therefore, there is a confusion whether it is a Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer, or senility related. Incidence is 5 in 100,000, so pretty low. But they may often require the shunt, either thicoperitoneal shunt or VP shunt. Sometimes instead of medium pressure, even the low pressure shunt may be indicated in this patient. Here, the main anesthesia issues would be associated medical conditions. Another condition is hydrocephalus ex vacuo. Here, the dilatation of the CSF fluid pathway would be because of the lack of brain tissue, the atrophy of the brain tissue. So intracranial pressure is not really increased, and usually it doesn't require any surgical management. If a patient comes for other incidental surgery with V patient in situ, then what? There is no absolute contraindication for giving spinal anesthesia, but many anesthesiologists would avoid it because of the possibility of risk of CNS infection. However, that is not has been proven. If they come for the laparoscopic surgery, but then there is a concern that the shunt system may fail because of the pressure during the pneumoperitoneum. So what can be done? The surgeon can intermittently check for the CSF flow while the pneumoperitoneum is being created. So the flow can be assessed visually and minimize the duration and pressure of the pneumoperitoneum. If a functioning VA shunt patient comes for neurosurgery, then sitting position is avoided because directly when the ventricles are open, air can go into the heart, and that can be of large amount. So that should be avoided. So that's all I have to say for the hydrocephalus over here. Just to summarize, presentation varies with the condition and the age of the patient. Acute hydrocephalus may need emergency surgery and optimization may not be possible. Identify the associated anomalies. Quite often it can be technically challenging, especially with a very large head. Alert monitoring is required, and there are multiple options of management apart from the VP shunt. One has to keep that in mind. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. This was for the hydrocephalus?
Yeah, this was for hydrocephalus. Now, should we take a discussion now, or since both the topics are related, you would like to?
As you want, ma'am.
Me to go ahead.
As you want. If you want to finish off hydrocephalus right now, we can finish off hydrocephalus right now, or we can take it at the end of the session once we finish both. So should we do it at the end?
Yeah, that also is possible. Okay. Am I having some disturbances with the internet thing or something? Or is it coming all right? Because
At my end, there is some breakage, ma'am. It is not coming seamlessly. So there could be some breakage.
Maybe. Let's hope that others are able to hear. Okay. So then I can...
Yes, we can continue with the meningomyelitis.
Continue. Yeah, no issues.
Both of them together.
Okay, coming to the second subject, that is meningomyelosis. Again, over here, our patient is...
Ma'am, but your slides are not moving, ma'am. I think you'll have to shut this thing down and reshare it again. This is a hydrocephalus slides, which is there. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
Coming to the second subject, meningomyelosis. Let us see our patient. Here, the patient is a neonate, 10 days old male baby, 2.8 kg, complaining with the swelling on the back since birth, which is dark in color. The parents are complaining that there is a watery discharge from the swelling since 3 days. And the patient also had low-grade fever since 1 day. Patient is also irritable and excessively crying since 1 day. As far as the history is concerned, birth history is concerned, it was a full-term spontaneous vaginal delivery, happened at the rural hospital. The mother had not taken any antenatal advice, medications, or any investigations or follow-up was not done. The baby cried immediately after birth and not yet immunized. On examination, patient is afebrile, heart rate is 150 per minute, respiratory rate is 46. There are no pallor, icterus, cyanosis. No other obvious congenital anomalies were noted. The patient was lying in the left lateral decubitus position with the wet dressing, and the defect seems to be 4x4 in size with partial skin cover in the lumbosacral effect area. So now the surgeons have decided to do this repair of the meningomyelosis at the earliest. So again, we go back to the basics. Meningomyelosis is a type of neural tube defect. It occurs due to the interruptions of migration of the neural crest cell. So in the first 4 weeks of the gestation, a neural tube is developed. Then it closes on itself and fuses. If there is a failure to fuse at the upper part of the tube, it may lead to encephalocele. If it happens at the lower part of it, then it may lead to spina bifida with or without meningomyelosis. The commonest site of defect is lumbosacral, and it may be associated with the other neural tube defects like sacral agenesis, diastomatomyelia, that is the split cord syndrome, and so on. Meningomyelosis is defined as a congenital defect in vertebral arches with cystic dilatation of the meninges and structural or functional abnormality of spinal cord. And meningocele, as shown over here, the meninges as well as the spinal cord has gone out into the outpouching. And meningocele is defined as a congenital defect in the vertebral arches with cystic distension of the meninges, but no abnormalities of neural tissue. The incidence is about 0.4 to 1 per 1,000 live birth. There are multiple causes for MMC to occur. Chromosomal and genetic conditions can occur very commonly, and therefore it may also happen in the parent or sibling who may have the associated neural tube defect. Amniotic bands can cause MMC. Maternal factors include alcohol use, caffeine intake, smoking, pollution, diabetes mellitus, obesity. Folate deficiency is one of the most common cause of MMC, associated reason for MMC in our country. Sometimes the mother may be taking even folic acid antagonists like valproic acid, carbamazepine, methotrexate, and so on, and that can also lead to MMC defect. Incidence is different in different races where these genetic conditions are common, and also common in lower socioeconomic status and the patients and the older maternal age. It can be easily diagnosed in the intrauterine phase itself during the fetal imaging, as seen in the fetal ultrasound. If the swelling is noted at the 18 weeks at USG itself, then further laboratory studies can be done, like serum alpha fetoprotein or amniotic fluid can be checked for identifying or assessing the things. At birth, the swelling will be immediately visible, and that can be seen. And immediately, it can be further diagnosed by the MRI scan spine. Usually, CT is not advocated because of the high radiation involved, but sometimes we do get patients with CT scan done. USG cranium, MRI brain and USG cranium also should be done in this patient to identify the associated cranial deformities. The presentation also varies in different patients. The patient may be completely asymptomatic with only a visible swelling over the neck with intact skin, or it may be no skin may be present. There can be leakage of the CSF, or the patient may have a progressive neurological disease. There can be kyphoscoliotic deformity. The neurodeficits can vary from absolute normal to paraplegia, paraparesis, cognitive dysfunction. Later on, there can be bladder bowel dysfunction. Initially, this may not be apparent. Infection, progressive bony and joint deformities may occur. And as the patient grows, there can be pathological fractures as well. The associated anomalies with meningomyelosis can be multiple. As far as the CNS is concerned, hydrocephalus is the most common associated anomalies. initially 15 to 25% may require the V patient, but once the MMC is closed, because there is a less space available for the CSF, immediately the hydrocephalus becomes apparent and V patient would be required immediately afterwards. Arnold Chiari malformation, as said, can be really major problem in these patients if it is associated. Along with that, apart from that, there can be craniofacial anomalies, Klippel-Feil syndrome, or intractable seizures, which may lead to another anesthesia issues. Other systems can be involved: AST, VST, PDA, genitourinary, gastrointestinal system may also be involved. Amongst the musculoskeletal, clubfoot or CTV is the most commonly associated anomaly. Vectral anomaly may also be there. So therefore, whenever there is an MMC baby born, evaluation by the neonatologist is advisable to identify the other abnormalities even before this, before anesthesiologist comes into the picture. Immediate postnatal care would be to take care of the swelling itself. The lesion needs to be covered by the moist dressing or plastic wrap and carefully assessed. These patients are high risk for latex allergy, so avoid any latex contact right from the first opportunity, and the closure of the meningomyelocele should be done, especially the open ones, ideally within the first 48 hours after the birth. So for assessment, always ask for the history of antenatal history of any drug ingestion, similar defect in the siblings, birthing difficulties, limb movements, whether the patient had was moving the limbs earlier and now it is not moving, and all those things would be important. Examine the nutritional status, other deformities. Thorough airway assessment is must. See the defect size, location, and condition. Air function, cranial nerves, motor deficits, everything should be assessed and documented. Respiratory system, again, because these are the very small neonates, quite often they are preemies. Apneic episodes are pretty common. Rule out evidence of aspiration is also common. So identify or rule out the associated anomalies. Preoperative workup would be HBCBC, platelet count, WBC count might be high, especially if patient has got systemic infection. MRI, as I said, spine and brain, both would be required. If patient is syndromic or so, 2D echo will identify the associated cardiac anomalies. So that would be required. USG abdomen would be useful. Grouping and cross-matching both should be done, because quite often the surgery is associated with the blood loss. Standard starvation guidelines would be applicable for these patients, but if there is a significant CSF leak, that volume needs to be compensated for. The anesthesia challenges are multifold. Apart from the age-related issues, there are coexisting diseases, airway-related issues, positioning, blood loss, hypothermia, latex allergy, and the patient's cardiac responses. So because of the neonatal age group, this itself is a high-risk group because of the obvious difference between the anatomy and physiology. They can have the characteristic transitional circulation. There can be impaired myocardial function, immature hepatic and renal function, and also underdeveloped lungs are possible in the preemie babies. Their temperature and glucose instability are very high, and they have poor tolerance for fluid restriction and fasting. So one has to be careful and tackle these things. Airway challenges, as we all know, the typical neonate, distinct differences from the adult or in the older age group. This changes, relatively large tongue, cephalad place larynx, and large epiglottis. All those things will lead to difficulty in visualizing larynx, risk of subglottic edema, early desaturation, sustained respiratory depression postoperatively, postoperative apnea, and if there is any additional airway anomaly, then it can add to the airway challenges. So one must have adequate preparation. Appropriate size equipments are necessary, and the experienced anesthesiologist should have good assistance for the intubation. Positioning for induction and intubation is another challenge, because there is a swelling and we don't want to avoid physical trauma to the lesion. So usually in whichever patient, the whichever position the patient was being nursed preoperatively, we use the same position, one of the lateral position. Our patient was used to left lateral position. So in the same position, we can induce and intubate, which is the most common thing. Other alternative is make an appropriately sized ring, donut ring, in which the lesion can lie, and then support the torso on the rolled towels or using the pillows or so that the whole patient can be supported. Sometimes needle decompression to reduce the size of the swelling has also been used. The decompression has to be done under sterile condition. However, this is not recommended. If the defect happens to be in the cervical position, sometimes people have taken the baby beyond the baby's head, beyond the edge of the table and intubated. But here you require a very good trained assistance. Lifting the whole body away from the table and intubating in air is not recommended. Anesthesia management, again, will have the standard non-invasive BP monitoring, but additional monitoring may be required as per the plan of the surgery, especially arterial line has been advocated by multiple authors. General endotracheal anesthesia is always given. Again, atropine premedication. Usually, now the tendency is not to use the atropine premedication, but still there are some people who are preferring it in neonatal age group. Now, when the head is kept straight in the prone position with the tube hanging, many anesthesiologists would not like to have the secretions loosening the stickings and all, and it is being used. However, routinely atropine is not used, when especially when the head is turned to one side. IV induction is preferred, thiopentone, propofol, and again, just like the other cases that I mentioned earlier, inhalational induction can be done. Awake intubation is not recommended. Etracurium can be given. Usually it is used for favorable pharmacological profile. However, succinylcholine may be used in this patient if there is no deficit, neurodeficit in the lower limbs. The rise in potassium in the neurologically normal patient is same as the normal patient. However, overall also, because they are relatively elective cases, there is enough time for adequate starvation, succinylcholine is usually not used. Short trachea has been reported in these patients. So ensure that the tube is in the trachea and not going endobronchially. Similarly, if the patient is larger than 2 years or 3 years, then microcuff tube can be used, and now its use is increasing, but ensure that it is the microcuff tube and the cuff pressure is being monitored. For neonates, it is not yet being recommended. Maintenance can be inhalational agents with opioids. However, in small babies, there can be reduced hepatic function, reduced blood flow because of the prone position and the pressure on the abdomen. And along with potent inhaled anesthetics, there can be excessive reduced clearance of fentanyl. So remifentanil is preferred if available in this situation. Paracetamol may be used intravenously or in the suppository format. Surgical positioning is also challenging. One has to be extremely careful. It should be pre-planned, allow the adequate access of the patient to the both surgeons as well as anesthesiologists. Long IV extension lines, circuit placements should also have to be taken care of. Prone position usually is given on the bolsters using the either horizontal or vertical, but make sure that the free abdomen is left free for the movements and check pulsations of the lower limb to ensure that the femoral vessels are not compressed. Take care of the eye. There should not be any pressure, and a proper pressure padding of the points, pressure points should be done. If it is cervical MMC, then the head will be lying straight. And in this situation, lightweight circuit should be used and it should be fixed properly so that no additional weight comes on the tube. Sometimes for this situation, even customized frames as shown one of in this picture has also been used. The tube comes out in the prone position through this hole and the eyes can be kept without the pressure. So such things are also used if it is appropriate, size appropriate. Two proper IV lines are sufficient for this patient's. Correct dehydration should be corrected, maintain normovolemia, major blood loss needs to be correct, replaced with the PRBC packed trial. These patients have low tolerance to blood loss and there is a risk of hypoglycemia. So monitor blood sugar and add it into the ringer lactate during in the IV fluids. They are also vulnerable to hypothermia because of the less subcutaneous fat. They do not shiver, large head, autonomic control is also abnormal and that can lead to delayed recovery and all. So one must prevent it by raising the OT ambient temperature, radiant heat lamps, use of warm air mattresses under the patient's body. Underbody mattresses are also available. Wrapping the extremity with the head with the cotton blankets, warm in infusion solutions and heated humidified gases. There can be bradycardia, tachycardia, hypotension, especially related with the blood loss. The bradycardia and cardiac arrest can occur, especially if there is a Arnold-Chiari malformation, brainstem compression can occur. The neck movements should be really, really, one has to be careful about. There can be hypercapnia, increased airway pressure, bronchospasm may occur. Endobronchial intubation is also possible. Desaturation can occur. So we have to be careful about the monitoring and treat it at the earliest. Certain CSF loss can cause hemodynamic instability. Accidental extubation and dislodgement of venous excess are best to be prevented rather than managed. Myelodysplasia patients, especially the diastomatomyelia patients, are very high risk for latex allergy. So these patients should be, the latex contact must be prevented. If the patient happens to be high risk patient, like he has already undergone multiple surgeries earlier, then one can give the prophylactically prednisolone and diphenhydramine and avoid latex contact exposure in any form like gloves, catheter, IV sets, everything non-latex can be used. Vigilant monitoring is the key. Watch for the bronchospasm, cardiovascular collapse, and if you are suspecting it, stop all anesthetics, give 100% oxygen, give hydrocortisone and vasopressors as per the need. Now, not all patients coming for MMC are neonates. Quite often they come in the older age group. Quite often they also come after the initial MMC closure for the repeated surgeries like CSF leak, or they may come again for as the growth occurs for de-tethering of the cord, because as the cord ascends upwards in the diastomatomyelia patient, there can be further scoliotic changes or the repeat surgery would be required. And here the neurosurgeons would be operating it and they would like to recognize the important structures and prevent the damage to the nerves during the surgery. So it is increasingly commonly applied to monitor the neuromonitoring is applied. The main modalities used are the motor evoke potentials, somatosensory evoke potentials, and electromyography. It needs to be monitored both in upper limbs as well as in lower limb. The upper limb acts as a control and bilaterally. Unfortunately for infants, the neural structures have not yet completed their development, so their interpretation becomes really difficult. Neuromonitoring or evoke potential monitoring can be affected by anesthesia, hypotension, and temperature. Inhalational agents will suppress both SSAP as well as MAP. Propofol and fentanyl in routine doses will cause no suppression and can be used. However, sudden large boluses may affect the evoke potentials. Ketamine can improve the response. So before the baseline is secure, is obtained, one can use ketamine. Neuromuscular blockers will suppress the MAP. So whenever MAP is to be used, the muscle blockers are not used. We can use the first dose for the intubation, but redosing is not advocated. What about the nitrous oxide? Again, I would like the audience to give their opinion about the nitrous oxide with neuromonitoring. So our routine anesthesia technique needs to be modified. Usually we use the TEVA, propofol infusion, with or without dexmedetomidine may be used, with the fentanyl, either infusion or intermittently. However, when it comes to neonate, we have a hesitation about giving the propofol infusion because of the risk of propofol infusion syndrome and the other their cardiovascular stability. So quite often, only opioid-based anesthesia with very low dose of volatile anesthetics have been used with measuring BIS. If muscle relaxant has been used, then redosing should not be used. There are case reports where only ketamine with remifentanil has been used for induction and intubation, and only nitrous oxide and remifentanil has been used for maintenance with BIS monitoring, and that has not affected the evoke potential monitoring with good results. Intraoperatively, if the responses are suppressed, what you can do? If they are suppressed uniformly in all the limbs, then check or rule out the hypothermia, whether the patient has recovered from the initial blockade or no, check that. Inadvertent, somebody has given an additional top-up, large bolus of opioid has gone or no, and stop inhalationals if it is being given. Optimize the oxygen delivery, increase the MAPS, and additional give 100% oxygen. Ensure that adequate blood supply is going to the spinal cord. Surgeon, on the other hand, especially if it is only in the lower limbs, surgeon will flood the area with the cold saline. The neurophysiologist will increase the strength of stimulus after some time and recheck it. Ketamine at this time will not be useful. Coming to reversal and recovery, most of these MMC patients can be extubated when the child is awake and breathing well, when the criteria for extubations are fulfilled. There can be delayed recovery, especially if the patient is hypothermic, prolonged effect of anesthetic agents, or if there is associated Chiari malformation or so, there can be need for the ventilatory support. Multiple postoperative complications can occur because of the airway obstruction, laryngospasm, apnea, bradycardia, convulsions, delayed recovery, and similarly surgical complications like wound infection, pneumonia, meningitis, seizures, have also occurred. CSF fluid leak can also happen. So to conclude, prevention of the rupture of the MMC sac is of prime importance preoperatively. We have to be very careful during positioning of the patient, during induction, intubation, as well as surgery. Airway management can be difficult at times. Proper IV access and securing it properly is essential. There has to be meticulous intraoperative IV fluid and blood management. Electrolyte imbalance should be treated. Temperature monitoring and maintenance is important. Always keep the possibility of latex allergy in mind, and there are risks associated with the associated disorders. So that's all. Thank you.
So thank you so much, ma'am. That was really nice and very well covered, right, from the physiology, from the basics up to the recent advances and the advanced issues with the hydrocephalus as well as meningomyelocele. So I'm sure it will be very, very useful for all the postgraduates. Just seeing the lecture again on YouTube before the exams or during their conduct of the anesthesia, they will very easily be able to revise everything of these two chapters at least. So, ma'am, if you allow, then we can take a few questions now.
Yeah, sure.
So, to begin with, ma'am, first was your question itself. You had wanted to know how. That was an interesting question. If there is a child with a large head, then what is the weight considerations? How do you calculate and consider the weight of the child?
Yeah, actually, I wanted to have some risk. Others. So has anybody?
I think nobody has
commented.
No one has commented. I think it should be based on the size of the head. How do we go about it, ma'am?
because there is nothing mentioned anywhere. So actually, I also wanted to have some feedback from others that how it can be done. Actually, this particular picture was taken from Dr. Poonam Ghodke's. In that particular report, the patient's weight was 5 kg and they have considered it as a 2.5 kg for the drug calculations and all. One practical thing that comes to my mind and which we have used is we weigh the patient completely and then we support or elevate the head in our hands so that the weight of the patient will be taken off the weighing machine. So we would probably roughly know the weight of the head. And from that, some rough calculation can be done. And we can judge and do. But anything better method or some other things are there. I'm open to those ideas and all.
What I did, ma'am, was after you asked the question, I did search the internet a little bit. And there was
okay, good.
In which what they've done is they've measured the circumference of the head. And they've assumed that head to be circular. So they've calculated, suppose the circumference is 50. So they have divided it by 2 pi, they calculated the radius, and then from that they have calculated the volume, assuming the head to be a sphere. And then whatever is the volume of the sphere, they have said that the density will be 1 gram of that. So they have reduced 1 gram for that. I mean, we don't do it, ma'am. I just saw it half an hour back.
Yeah, because all these things are rough calculation, but it just does give us some idea that what would be the what can be the weight of the torso at least.
Right,
that
right.
We can judge. Again, the brain, head doesn't mean only water. It also contains some of the blood circulation and everything. So it may not be accurate, but at least it will be little better than the other things.
So Dr. Anmol Jindal, he wants to know what is the absolute indication of using succinylcholine in such patients, even if rocuronium is available. Can we avoid using muscle relaxants in such patients, ma'am?
Which patient he was asking? I'm not sure.
For hydrocephalus patients. This is the hydrocephalus portions.
Hydrocephalus patients, if it is only large head, then once you give good position, intubation is usually easy. So practically, succinylcholine is not required in almost all patients, except when the patient is really, really almost arresting or that sort of thing, and you don't even want to wait for longer time. In such situation, even the rocuronium would not be appropriate because that also will take time. But practically, for many years, we have not used succinylcholine in these patients at all.
Right. So what I will do, ma'am, is after all the questions have been answered, what I'll do is I'll allow all the participants to unmute themselves. And just in case I've not been able to present their questions as per their wish, they can just have a chat with you directly also if they want to add or comment or anything. So I think it is for hydrocephalus that they want. Dr. Anmol wanted to know about succinylcholine that you have answered. Another question is by Dr. Deepshikha. She wants to know why nitrous oxide cannot be used. And this is for endoscopic ventriculostomy patients. That was the discussion that we were having that time.
Okay. Endoscopic ventriculostomy involves irrigation fluid. So now, through the irrigation fluid, quite often air bubbles can go in the ventricles. If we are using nitrous oxide, they will expand significantly. Multiple equipments also go through the endoscope. The multiple equipments, they go in and out, and every time a new equipment goes in, some air bubbles would go in. So we ensure that there is no air bubble going through the irrigation fluid, but these other air bubbles are just impossible to avoid. And under vision, we are actually able to see the multiple air bubbles into the ventricles. So whenever we see large multiple air bubbles, we stop the nitrous oxide. We do give it initially, but when we see the air bubbles, we can stop it. And later on, tell the surgeon to properly, thoroughly give wash, ensure that most of the air is removed out, and then get the scope out. However, it is best avoided, because then otherwise it will cause a lot of several cases of pneumoencephalus. So it is better to avoid.
Right. So another question that Dr. Deepshika wants to know is, what is the ideal solution that can be used for irrigation?
Both normal saline as well as Ringer lactate have been used. Our setup, we use Ringer lactate. Ringer lactate is associated with causing hyperkalemia if large amount of it is going inside the brain. But what has been commonly observed, that preoperatively most of these patients are hypokalemic. So actually, when you use the Ringer lactate, they become normokalemic. So that is something which we have found to be beneficial, and that is being used. I think most of the centers are using the Ringer lactate. I have not yet come across the balanced salt solution and newer solutions for this purpose.
Okay, so next I will encourage Dr. Naresh Parival to ask the questions directly to Madam. I'll unmute him and then he can share his views about dexmedetomidine. But before that, ma'am, there was one question that you had asked. Why can't we go ahead with endoscopic third ventriculostomy in children below 6 months?
Yeah, I don't see any answer over there.
Yes. So nobody was able to respond to that.
In the children below 6 months, this ICP does not rise much because of the bones the bones are not yet fused. The fontanelles are open. And there is no increase in ICP. So ICP remains more or less normal, or there is not much change. So any fluid flow through one area to another requires some sort of pressure gradient. So because in this patient, there is no pressure gradient developed, there is no continuous flow of CSF from the third ventricle to subarachnoid space. So over a period of time, if there is no flow, this punctured area will heal, and there is this ventriculostomy will close. So it doesn't work for a longer time. It just gets, so it doesn't function, and therefore you require some system which sometimes it first surgery when they come at the age of 3 months, 4 months, VPshunt is being done, and later on when they come, like our patient that I mentioned, when they come at 3 or 4 years or like that, endoscopic third ventriculostomy can be easily done.
Correct. So I'd encourage Dr. Naresh Parival, sir, to unmute himself and share his experience. Is Dr. Naresh available? Dr. Naresh Parival?
Yes, he's available.
He's available, yeah. So, sir, could you just mention your dexmedetomidine is quite widely used for, yes, sir, yeah.
Yes. At the outset, let me clear that I am not a pediatric anesthesiologist. I just have a theoretical knowledge about this dexmedetomidine in pediatrics. I am an occasional pediatric anesthesiologist and have never used this in such procedures.
Right,
so there are quite a number of references for using dexmedetomidine in pediatrics, as it has neuroprotective effects, and it is also used for intra-op neuromonitoring quite widely. Recently, I presented dexmedetomidine ketamine for pediatric procedural sedation at a national conference. So I just had a theoretical, references for that. I just wanted to know your views about this.
Dexmedetomidine.
Just a passing remark. You said dexmedetomidine can be used, but it is quite widely used. I have seen many references.
Yeah, it
recently,
can be used.
It is
very
being
easily
used like anything, though off-label.
So Teva-based anesthesia, I had written just the word Teva, that propofol as well as dexmedetomidine, either alone, propofol alone or with dexmedetomidine, it has been used and is very good for this intraoperative neuromonitoring. But yeah, I am also not a pediatric anesthesiologist. So whatever patients our neuro anesthesia, they are usually not neonatal age group. So older age group, we have used it very successfully and all, but I am yet to do a case in neonate with neuromonitoring.
Yes, I have used dexmedetomidine and ketamine. I have used dexmedetomidine and ketamine combination right from neonate to, all kids, but not for these procedures, intra-op neuromonitoring, because I have not done these cases. But I have used it quite a lot, dexmedetomidine and neonates also.
That should be good enough, because we have hesitation about.
That's why I wanted your views about it.
Yeah. Right. So thanks for telling us that. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Yeah, there's another question by Dr. Anil. He wants to know whether we can use only sevoflurane for induction. Inhalational induction with sevoflurane.
In any of these situations?
I think he must be for meningomyelitis, maybe yes. Yeah, any of these.
Because only sevoflurane without relaxant is not advocated. The patient should be, because they are raised ICP, even if you give the deep plane of anesthesia, the ICP can increase significantly. So for any patient with raised ICP, it should not be, it is not advocated, and you must use the proper relaxant. Nowadays, the relaxant techniques are much better, and we intubation equipments and everything has also improved. So there is not much problem about intubating or ventilating this patient. If once you relax, so there is no real indication that you should avoid relaxant. Secondly, some people are avoiding relaxant for neuromonitoring. If that is his point, that because we want to do the neuromonitoring, we can avoid that. The neuromonitoring per se starts much later after the induction, and by that time the patient is always out of whichever agent we use. Even vecuronium, even after that patient comes out of that agent significantly. By the time you finish the things and all, the neurophysiologist attaches all the pins and all, the patient would be pretty okay. And we always use neuromonitor junction, not in the NMT monitor is being used, so then that is quite okay. So there is no indication, not recommended. Just recently I attended one pediatric anesthesia CME. There also he said that without relaxant, it is not appropriate. Besides that, I had done one study some time ago where the ICP was monitored during induction and only deep anesthesia, however deep and with whichever agent you give, only partially controls the rise in ICP during intubation. So it always goes up, and even with deep intubation, induction, it can be dangerous. So in raised ICP patient, it should, it will be hazardous.
Right, ma'am. And just, I think this should be the last question. And in fact, it was asked by you yourself, ma'am, regarding nitrous oxide use for intraoperative neurophysiological monitoring. Whether nitrous oxide should be used, and then you yourself had mentioned that there were some people who had used nitrous oxide with fentanyl as the sole agent. So what was that, ma'am? Nitrous oxide for intraoperative neurophysiological monitoring, that can be used, I believe.
Yeah, it can be used. The thing is, nitrous oxide has got a variable response. Sometimes it helps, doesn't interfere. Sometimes it interferes. So if you are using inhalational agent, and with that, if you use the nitrous oxide, it will depress or suppress the alone, it may not. So when you are using it only nitrous oxide with this opioids and all, it has been used successfully. Again, when we get different types of neurophysiologists, different neurophysiologists coming over here, at that time also, their choices are different. Some are saying okay to nitrous oxide, some are saying not okay to nitrous oxide, and there is a variability. We have found that nitrous oxide, if you give alone, without sevoflurane, it is quite okay. It does not interfere. But if you are using it with sevoflurane, or with other inhalational agent, then it will definitely interfere, and you need to have your MAC below 0.5. So 0.4, 0.5 MAC of inhalational agent is quite okay, and that can be used. So because there is a variation in the nitrous oxide effect, I had asked that question.
So thank you so much. And I think we have come to the end of this wonderful, wonderful session. And for any cases that the PGs might have on hydrocephalus and meningomyelocele, I think this 1 hour will brush them up pretty thoroughly for their preparations. So I thank you so much for your valuable time, ma'am. Just for the information of everybody, all the listeners, ma'am, this is the 23rd session of the ISA online PG class. And these sessions are available offline on the YouTube channel. You just have to type ISA online PG class. And after some time, this whole session will be uploaded there too. It is also available at the isaweb.in. And it is really useful because postgraduates are able to listen to stalwarts like yourself take the classes themselves. And in this series, the next class will be taken by Dr. Girija Prasad Rath, sir, who is a faculty at AIIMS in New Delhi. And he'll be taking a class on anesthetic considerations for posterior fossa surgeries. So that I believe was also a very, very important topic. And with that, I please accept our heartfelt gratitude, ma'am. Thank you so much for sparing your time.
Thank you. I thank you. I say as well. Thank you, Dr. Nishima.
Thank you. Thank you.